So we'll just give it a moment. There's just under 20 folks that have signed in, and it's still ticking upwards at a rapid rate. Oh, I see you, Brian. And Greg. Okay, we seem to have leveled off at 22 attendees for the time being. Welcome everyone. This is the public consultation for the proposed development at 30 to 48 Chamberlain. I'm Miles and I work with Councillor Sean Menard. I'm a councillor's assistant in his office and I deal with planning files. Sean, I'm gonna hand it over to you now.
Okay, thanks very much, Miles. And thanks everyone for attending this evening. We've got a good discussion set for the 30 to 48 Chamberlain development application that has been submitted into the city. We've distributed some notices to residents nearby recently about this session, and hopefully you got the correction. I think we had originally said 4:30, it's at 6:30, so thanks for being able to be here. We are going to be recording the session as well, so if somebody misses something or there's others that weren't able to join us tonight, we'll have that in our Capital Ward office and able to get it to you afterwards as well. I wanted to, I'll do a brief introduction, but how this evening's gonna work is that there'll be a presentation. And I believe that's Kirsten that's gonna be doing that, who's with us here, and Barry Hoban as well. And then, so presentation from the developer, then we're going to have just a brief explanation by city staff on some of the process and the timelines that we're looking at. And then there'll be some questions and comments facilitated by Miles. The community association will go first, and Carolyn McKenzie, I see, is here as well on us with us as one of the panelists. And after that, we'll go to general questions and open up the floor. Just in terms of the history of this file, I have met you know, with the developer and talked through some of what they're proposing here. We've also spent, it must be 2 years now, Pete, on the Bank Street Heightened Character Study. I think we're 2 years in, and a lot of effort and work put into the Bank Street Heightened Character Study to make sure that we're assessing what height can be taken in that area, all through Bank Street, south of the 417, as well as Chamberlain, Isabella, all the way through to Lansdowne Park. So a ton of work that's gone into that. And I think we're at a pretty much a conclusion. It's going to be going to planning committee fairly soon with some of the final recommendations. But the recommendations reached in there are different than what the proposal is, than the application has been submitted to the city on this application. And so for us, we really want to support the Bank Street Heightened Character Study. And the main purpose behind that, the reason why we did that study in the first place, was to try to get some consistency at City Hall and in what buildings were being put up and what their height was, because we were getting things all over the map, and there was no consistency of what we could take within that area and how much densification, intensification we were going to see along that corridor. I think we've got a good plan now, and we've got a lot of developers and the community association, a lot of residents that have chimed in. A lot of them support it. Some of them don't, but I think we're going to come to a consensus on it and try to get this thing through City Hall. The issue with this application is it doesn't adhere to the Bank Street Heightened Character Study. And for us, that's very important. We put, again, a lot of time and effort into that and want to see it respected. So there's a whole bunch of other reasons why this is there's concerns here for our office. We've shared that with the developer. They know our position on it. They're very respectful and nice people, though, and certainly going to have a good discussion tonight. So I'm happy they're able to join us and go through the issue with us tonight. So I think with that, I will pass it over to Kirsten and to Barry to walk us through what this is, what it looks like, and then we'll move from there. So Kirsten and Barry, over to you.
Great, thanks, Councillor Menard. So before, I'm going to do the presentation, so before I share my screen and start that, Just so everybody knows, I'll introduce our team here on the screen. So my name is Kirsten Nitsche. I'm a senior planner with FO10. And with me today from FO10 are Brian Casagrande and Timothy Bede. And the rest of the applicant team from Barry Hoban's office, the architect for the project is Barry Hoban and David Anderson. And then we also have Greg Moore from Quantum Project Management. So he's a project management side of the project here today. So I'm going to just share my screen here. Wait, I don't know if I can do that, Miles. One second. Oh, wait, here we go. See, I do this so many times a week, and yet I'm still figuring it out. Okay, so can everybody see this? Perfect. Okay. So thank you guys for coming tonight and listening to our presentation and participating in this conversation for the development proposal at 30 to 48 Chamberlain Avenue. So Steve Gauthier, after this presentation, will go through, you know, the city's process, but just very briefly, we've submitted on behalf of the property owner a zoning bylaw amendment to permit a 16-story development that's mixed use in nature with a 3-story podium and a 13-story tower component. So Barry will go through that design analysis and you'll see some more detailed design and visuals to go with that. I'm gonna focus on the planning conversation just leading up to Barry's component. So, okay, so a bit of context though, as we all know, the site is at 30 to 48 Chamberlain Avenue. Chamberlain Avenue runs along the north side of the Glebe. It is a one-way street running in a west to east direction, as you can see here. So currently the site is fairly undeveloped or underutilized in the sense that it consists mainly of surface parking with two low-rise commercial, businesses. It does back onto the Rosemary Avenue residential neighborhood to the south, as you can see here. Further east along Chamberlain, you see the same pattern with a large service parking lot, low rise commercial type development, as well as to the west, there's a small commercial building, as well as the embassy for Yemen to the west, as well as some other low rise buildings that are fairly new to the west. So this is a bit of context. You can see it's fairly close to Bank Street, as we all know, Bank Street being a main, the traditional main street leading to the downtown and south. Just to give a little bit more context, you can see just some more views here. This red outline just shows the site in context from different views. You can see the low-rise residential, Central Park, the highway, of course, to the north, as well as Chamberlain along the north side of the site. So just to give some, I guess, on the street perspectives, you can see that it is fairly hard surfaced, as we mentioned, a lot of asphalt, minimal landscaping, and very close to the highway. So the highway presents a two-story, barrier to between the Glebe and to Centertown to the north. Lots of surface parking, as you can see. So that's just a bit of context. As I said, you're all very familiar with this site. So from a policy perspective, and looking at the site is located on Chamberlain Avenue, which is an arterial road. It's also designated as a transit priority corridor in the official plan. And that's important because within the general urban area, so the general urban area is where this site is located from a policy perspective, the general urban area does indicate that taller buildings can be considered on these types of roads that are arterial roads and transit priority corridors. So looking at that site, you know, we've gone through the design analysis and feel that what we've proposed is appropriate and can be considered for taller height, taller buildings on this site. From a zoning perspective, the site is currently zoned GM, which is general mixed use, subzone 4. It does have a maximum floor space index of 3. So that indicates you can build up to 3 times the size of the lot area. It does permit a wide variety of, you know, low scale or low pro, I guess, low, de- sorry, sorry, commercial uses, some minor institutional uses on the site. The maximum height permitted is 14 meters. So as part of the zoning bylaw amendments, we're not seeking to change the GM zoning. We feel that the uses there are appropriate. They do permit residential. They do permit light commercial, personal service businesses that we're, you know, looking to keep on the site. But we're looking for site-specific provisions related to the height from an increase of 51 meters to permit the proposed development. So as I do have here outlined, so we're also looking to extend the exception. So on the eastern portion of the site, there is a medical facility use. That's an orthodontics office. So that we are looking to extend that across the site to enable that business to come back when the site is redeveloped within the ground floor of the building. As I said, we're looking to increase the height to 51 meters to permit the proposed development, reduce the rear yard tower setback to 10 meters, as well as the interior side yard setback, reduce parking lot landscaping based on the proposed development, reduce the driveway and drive aisle width to 6 meters, and permit stacked bicycle parking. So right now the zoning bylaw doesn't really give flexibility for anything than your typical bicycle parking. So we just wanna make sure we have options for stacked bicycle parking. So all of these zoning exceptions that we're requesting are detailed in the planning rationale that is available online to go with the application. So you can look through that in more detail as well. So before I hand it over to Barry, just wanted to bring up the site plan to show what we're proposing. So as I said, it's a 16-story building. It is proposed to have 150 dwelling units as well as some ground floor commercial. It does propose to have 150 underground parking space, 100 parking spaces with 10 of those surface and easily accessible from Chamberlain Avenue for visitors and the commercial use. It will have bicycle parking as well within the underground parking garage. So the floor plate's not marked on here, but the tower floor plate is 665 square meters, which is lower than the city's recommended maximum 750 square meters. And as you can see here, there is a rear yard setback to provide and maintain for trees that are existing on the property line to the south. So I'm gonna turn it over to Barry, and Barry's gonna go through the evolution of the design and speak to the design analysis component.
Just unmute myself. Yeah, okay, so we have been working on this site since 2019. I understand that the client, in fact, in advance of that, reached out to have Votown do an analysis in 2018. We started to look at it from an architectural perspective. I think there are a number of things that shape my opinion of the site. First of all, in the 80s, we developed two of the small apartment, the office buildings that are to the west of this on Chamberlain, and know Chamberlain very well. Chamberlain is a speed route between Bronson and Bank Street with an upside that takes you into up to Kent Street. And so it's a fast moving street, no opportunity for parking on the street, no opportunity for stopping and starting. And so there are a number of things that we think are really important and shape our attitude to the building. And notwithstanding is the influence of the Queensway, which is elevated from those photos we just looked at. I think if anybody's walked along Chamberlain Avenue, painfully aware of that. So in looking at a blob building or a wall building that's basically mid-rise from west to east, number of detrimental things if you want to optimize density. One is the notion that half your units are low rise and facing into the Queensway and Chamberlain, and the other half are looking into backyards of Rosebery. And particularly in a low rise building, I think there is more sense of overlooking than in a high rise building, and certainly shaped our attitude to how we develop the form of the building. So if you flipped ahead, please. So essentially we took that low rise mass and stuck it on its end and basically said, let's do a tall building. Let's do a building with a very small footprint. So slide one tries to show that. We basically deployed mass that allows our building to have fewer units basically facing the Queensway at a lower level and fewer units actually looking into backyards at the lower levels to the south. And once we did that, we looked at the notion we wouldn't do a building alone because there needs to be, I believe, some consistency along Chamberlain to kind of animate that street and to actually give it some character, largely determined now by open parking lots. Slide two in that podium would allow us also to shield us from noise. And what we've done, the sound studies on this that show that on average. From day and night, there's a possibility of a 10%, a 10 decibel reading from 70 to 60 during the day and from 60 to 50 at night. That is absolutely significant in terms of reduction. And then the last thing we did on slide three was articulate the building with an angled west facade for two reasons. One is to enhance and improve the sun shadowing. Even though it's on the north side of the buildings on Rosebery, there is some sun shadowing that would occur late in the day in the summer. And then the other reason is that we have a smaller facade facing south and impacting properties to Rosebery. And that facade is the equivalent of basically three residential lots on Rosebery. We've done that calculation. So if we flip ahead, so one of the big things about Chamberlain is that there's no room to stop. And so we've invested a fair amount of space on our site for one, providing visitor parking at grade so people aren't confused. Two is the ability to pull in, turn around, and come back out. Again, try to avoid confusion about drop-off. And today with Uber Eats and Uber and parcel delivery, Amazon, that becomes an increasingly really important part of this. And by the way, the intention of our building is to be a residential apartment building, a rental building. So on the ground floor, you can see what we have commercial space that faces out onto Chamberlain. We have currently on the site a dentist, and the intention is that we would bring that occupier back to the commercial space. This is not a retail location just because of the nature of Chamberlain Avenue, but there are service-oriented retail things, service-oriented commercial that makes sense in terms of that street. And then you can see that the rear of the building, we're returning residential to residential so that there's no conflict there. In some of our consultation with neighbors on Rosebery, there was comments about lighting, there was comments about garbage being picked up on site. Everything like that is internalized. So garbage is stored down below. Basically the notion of shielding as lights when you come in at night, all that kind of stuff is basically addressed and will be addressed as we get further into site plan. So if you flip ahead. So, you know, the first slide that you're really gonna see that looks at three dimensionally is the notion that we've got a podium that's essentially three stories high, and you can see the coated area that allows you to visibly see where the parking is as you're coming from the west to the east. And the notion that the base of the building is much more animated. We're also showing some amenity on the rooftop. And if we flip to the next slide, it's important to realize this in the context. So you if you walked along Chamberlain, and if you looked at those photos, you realize that the Queensway is elevated a full 20 feet, and then there's a sound fence on top of it. And really our podium is intended to be slightly above that. So there's a number of reasons for that. One of is to provide that continuous barrier from a sound perspective. Second is to animate Chamberlain and try to make it into something a little bit more humane. There is room for street trees along that street edge. And the properties we developed at 68 and 72 Chamberlain accurately show what a mature tree can look like on that street, so that's possible. So basically trying to humanize that edge, but also from an architectural perspective, and if we flip to the next slide, this basically shows the cross section, the relationship to the Queensway. And one more, we'll talk a little bit more about the base of the building. So I believe actually most of the glebe, the height and character of the glebe of Bank Street itself, is driven by a 2 and 3 story envelope. At least that's what most people recognize. There's a few 3-story buildings on Bank Street, you know, the Paperies being one of them. And a couple of buildings that are closer to the north end of Bank Street. But the notion there is actually to make that base strongly articulated so there's some connection to it. And then the next slide would suggest that what happens above is much lighter. And in this case, it's very delicate. Kristen just mentioned very briefly that the footprint of the building is 650 meters squared, whereas the high-rise guidelines in the city of Ottawa and the OP suggest 750. So it's quite a small footprint. In fact, I don't think we've done another building with a footprint that small. These are other examples of projects we've done around Ottawa. The most recent one is the bottom right, which is the student residence that we did on Laurier and Friel, showing how an articulated base actually animates the street. If I flip ahead. And at the same time, some articulation of the built form that has your windows looking slightly northeast, southwest, just basically to break up that facade. There's another, go ahead to the next one. There's another natural benefit from that, and that has to do with wind shear off the building. When you have a strong podium, it helps the ground level in terms of comfort. So the three big moves that we looked at in terms of, when we look at the notion of height, and I know people are not happy with height as it's as just as a concept. I'm gonna make a case that height actually is not the relevant issue, it's deployment of mass. And it's how we, and what's the impact on those properties which are to the south. And my simple point is the notion of angular planes and these kind of devices are only one mechanism for actually how to make a building more responsive to its location. And these are three different thoughts about how we've tried to affect impacts in this case. Number one is the trees. We've surveyed all the trees in the backyards of those properties to the south, and we've set back the building itself, but also set back what happens below grade to allow those trees to survive. Second is the notion of noise. And as I mentioned previously, there's a significant decibel reduction with the use of the podium as a device. And then the third is some shadows. At the end of June, between 5 and 6, as the sun is getting low, the angle of the building vastly reduces the shadow impact on those properties that are to the south. And I have already mentioned that the reduced facade on that side actually reduces the sky plane. And I think we speak a lot about sun shadows, but the reality is that it's only at the end of the day in summertime where it has an impact. There's absolutely no impact throughout the rest of the year because their buildings are on the north side of the property. So a more significant thing from my perspective is the sky plane. So in the case of a delicate tower and a low podium, the sky plane is preserved for well over half the site. And I think that's a really important shaper of how a building fits in to a specific context. The notion of a high-rise building as well as a mid-rise or a low-rise, certainly in a mid-rise building, basically, when you're connected to the ground, there's an overlook situation with respect to backyards. In the case of a high-rise building, you're looking more of a long distance. So I'll flip ahead on that theme. And just before we leave this, and on tree conservation, you can see where the trees are highlighted on the rear property line that are not on our property, but the building has been set back along the red dotted line on our property to enhance the tree preservation. So we flip ahead, and this is just showing that same thing in section that shows the offset of the lower part of the building. And if we flip ahead, I mentioned sky plane. So we took the trouble of modeling our building from a number of views. Slide one's the left-hand side, render the building from Lion Street. And just full transparency, we show one where it's obviously there's tree foliage and one where there's not. And you can see exactly what the building does in terms of the sky plane. And then the second slides are taken from Renfrew that allows you to see that across Central Park. And then the top slide, I guess, must be in the spring because I think there's water in the park. And then the third slide is taken from Bank Street, looking over top of the Ambassador Apartments. So if we flip ahead, one more. This basically then showing the building as you're from the west looking towards the east. And if we flip ahead to one of the aerials, I just want to pick up on the notion of the sky plane. So this is kind of a relevant diagram as far as I'm concerned. One is that you can see the number of buildings that along Rosebery, which are totally unaffected by this building. The mass of the podium relates more or less to the building height of those buildings on Chamberlain, but on Rosebery. But more importantly, you're starting to see the notion of a building and the long view that's possible from this site. So instead of overlooking down, I think your prospect is looking out. And there's no question that that what we're trying to marry is impact on terms of neighbors and basically at the same time, create the most advantageous building on behalf of our client. Full transparency, that's what we're trying to do. But I believe those two themes are not mutually exclusive. I think they're mutually supportive. And the notion of a very small tower with units facing in all directions allows us to do that. So this is looking to the south, and we go one more. This is looking to the north. I know there's all kinds of development planned on the north of the Queensway. That's not really my interest right now. We're really dealing with the Glebe and the notion that Chamberlain and Isabella are very special corridors, which demand unusual responses. So I can leave it there in terms of setting the stage for discussion. We have floor plans and we have sun shadows, but I think realistically, the discussion will probably go on a bunch of other ways, and it's worthwhile just opening that up and for discussion. If that's the program, I think this would be a reasonable place to pause. And I think according to Councillor Menard's order, I believe that it would go to the city next to make comments.
That's right.
Go ahead, Miles.
Yeah, so thanks, Barry. Steve, just before we throw to you, Steve Gauthier, folks can see him on the call. He is the city planner assigned to this development proposal. So we're going to go to him, and he's going to just briefly outline the process and where we are at within that process. But before he does, I just wanted to note that there is a Q&A function that we will be using for this webinar. I think folks have heard enough information now that they're going to start wanting to formulate questions, and please go ahead and do so and start typing them into the Q&A function. And so when we get to the Q&A part of the meeting, we can start right away. And also, while you're crafting your questions, please be advised that it's not just Barry Hoban and Kirsten and the developer team here that you can pose questions to. You can also ask questions of the city planner and other city staff on this call, including the authors of the Glebe Height and Character Study that are here. So we'll go over to Steve, and then we're going to go over to the Community Association for initial comments, but please go ahead and start with the Q&A. Okay, Steve, over to you.
Okay, so where are we in the process? The application was circulated just before Christmas. The common due date was January the 29th. I have agreed to extend the common period to capture this information sessions. So anybody that hasn't submitted comments so far, I would invite you to do so within the next days or the next week. That's where we are with the comment period. Obviously, I've shared already most of the comments received with the applicant. There's going to be further comments, as I explained. There will be a discussion with the development team and the city. The community association is also welcome to participate in the discussion. So, if we reach a consensus on the required revisions to the or adjustment to the application, this item could go to April 18 planning committee. So after that, the item would be brought to council, and subsequent to a council decision, there would be the appeal period. So I guess essentially that's the process. So if there's any question, feel free to ask.
Thanks, Steve. Okay, so we have Carolyn McKenzie here from the Glebe Community Association, who heads up the planning committee. We also have Peter Hook on the call as well that I've promoted to panelists. Carolyn, let's start with you if you have any preliminary comments you'd like to make, and then feel free to throw from Peter to Peter from there, if you like.
Sure. Thank you, Miles. Thanks, everyone, and thank you again to the applicant team for taking the time to do this. We've had perhaps I've lost count of how many presentations you've made to various groups, the planning committee, the GCA, to the group of residents immediately adjacent to this property, and now this one. There may be others. So anyway, I appreciate the effort that you're putting into that and the discussion that we've had on this. What I will say, obviously, is going back to the comments, earlier comments, and Peter Giles is here today as well. A lot of effort has gone into the Bank Street height and character study. A lot of time has been taken in looking at all the properties in the study area, of which this is one. And that study recommended a maximum of 6 stories on this site, rather than the 16 stories that's being proposed here with the 3-story podium. That being said, I like to think that we are nimble enough and flexible enough to and open enough to any proposal that comes forward and shift our thinking if we felt that a compelling case was being made. And I think that there are some interesting points and some advantages to, I'll say, playing with the massing. And I say that in a very positive sense, looking at how the massing could be reconfigured in a way that would have net benefits to the community. But I think ultimately, we've reached out, and I think the immediate residents are quite active on this file, as are others who will see this building, and as are many others who have been engaged in the Bank Street study. And I think on balance that we don't feel that there's a compelling case to provide permission for this. And I guess a couple concerns that while, the properties to the southwest end of the proposed development, may experience relatively less shadowing, the shadow impacts on properties to the southeast in closer proximity to the Point Tower in particular are significant, as are the shadow impacts on Bank Street itself, and even properties to the east of Bank Street, looking at the shadow studies that had been provided. I think overlook and during the presentation, there was a fair bit of discussion about overlook seemed to be a sense that the majority of the overlook would be sort of a longer view. And I believe that to be true for people who might live on the upper stories of this building, but certainly for people who don't live on the upper stories, that overlook will still continue to be significant and really focused on the properties that are immediately adjacent. So that's a big concern as well. And I guess I would say that I do find it interesting that elsewhere where we've had proposals on Bank Street and in the neighborhood for buildings that are 6 or 7 stories, else and that have some building step backs and so on, where there's some concern because of the proximity of that building to low rise 2.5-3 story the existing residential, the community is generally told, that's appropriate, there's nothing inappropriate about that overlook. But in this case, because the application wants to go from to establish the 3-story and then establish the Point Tower, then suddenly that overlook of 6 stories onto the low rise is suddenly a problem that this provides a solution to. So I'll point that out because I think there's a there seems to be a little bit of sort of having your cake and eating it too. And I'm not saying that this is necessarily the same group, but just in terms of what the community hears as rationale for height. And again, I'm someone who I try not to object to height just on the basis of height. It's really should be about thinking about those, about the impacts. And yet I find that to be an inconsistency in this case that's a bit striking. I think those are really the main issues that I think we see. I guess the other thing I would point out, and there was some discussion, I think, or some implication about the city's high-rise guidelines and how they may or may not apply and how they perhaps should be taking other factors into account. There are better ways. Perhaps the high-rise guidelines should be revisited. I don't know if they don't take into account what the proposal such as this would have to offer. But I don't see how those guidelines are being and the requirements of those guidelines are being specifically addressed here. And I think that is a bit telling. In this case, in the fact that they are there, they are the high-rise guidelines in effect, and I would have thought that that it would behoove the applicant group to address those. And if they have reason to say that something should be rethought, then that's fine. But let's at least see how those high-rise guidelines apply, given that those are the guidelines that are in effect. We want to see, I guess I would close, I don't want to sound like completely negative, because I'm a big supporter of seeing that property and other properties that are going to replace surface parking lots, which add nothing to the neighborhood. I'm a huge supporter of that. I think the community would love to see those properties developed and to see that contribute to the city's growth management objectives in so doing. But I hope that we're not going to get ourselves into a situation where the community is somehow being seen as being, you know, anti-development, anti, you know, NIMBY to adding more people to the neighborhood because the community may not be supportive of this proposal, whereas I believe the community is generally supportive of a six-story proposal that would see many people, given it's a residential building that's being proposed, added to the neighborhood and joining this neighborhood. So I hope you don't see that, and I hope that we're not looking at there was also some mention of how this proposal would replace those surface parking lots. That's great, but I hope that we're not getting into a situation where it's either a surface parking lot or a development like this, and you know those are the two choices. I think that would be a false choice. Anyway, I'll leave it there. I do appreciate all the conversation. I think this is a situation where we've had lots of really good and constructive discussion, and I appreciate the discussion. Unfortunately, I think this is a case where we may agree to disagree. So I'll leave it at that, and I look forward to hearing from others. Thank you very much.
Excellent comments, Carolyn. Thank you for that. Peter, did you also want to add anything to what Carolyn has said already?
Okay. No. Carolyn seems to have covered everything. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. We're going to go into the Q&A now. I'm just going to note that it looks like someone else is also acting as arbiter over the question and answer function. So I urge my fellow panelists to not do that. I will handle sorting the questions into answered or still open. So please refrain from doing that to whoever is, but let's get started. One thing I don't know if folks saw in the chat, but I did want to highlight that if you see a question posed in the Q&A box that you also would like to see answered, you can upvote, which is a novel function I just became aware of. And it's a little thumbs up button you can press. to indicate that, and it'll boost the question up the list, showing, demonstrating that there's support for that question and we can get to it sooner. Also, feel free to specify who you'd like to see answer your question or speak to your question when you're posing it. So you're welcome to direct the question. If not, I'll just open it to whoever wants to speak to it, but feel free to do so. Okay, with that aside, I'm going to go out.
Before you jump in, I've just wanted to see if Pete had anything that he wanted to add. He's kindly joined us tonight, and he has been the one with the pen on Bank Street Heightened Character Study and very knowledgeable of this area. I'm not sure, Pete, if you wanted to say anything or just here to observe, but I did want to give you that opportunity.
Thanks, Councillor. Appreciate that. I don't have anything specifically prepared. I can go through, you know, rationale for height if needed, but I think that's already been covered, especially internally. We've gone over this, you know, many times, but if others want to hear, you know, we could do that. In terms of timing for the study, we are trying to wrap it up. We're kind of caught up on a few last minute issues with a few properties. Afterwards, once that's resolved, it, because it's an OPA, it still does have to go for, you know, a formal circulation. So we are looking for, you know, at another few months likely. So this probably won't land at Planning Committee until the spring sometime, likely May or June.
Okay, thanks for that. Miles, back to you.
Thank you. And you're always welcome to intervene, Sean, of course. Okay, so the first question is from Rena. They ask, the city determined a maximum height based on site characteristics such as depth of the lots at the proposed site. How was that taken into consideration by the applicant?
Hi, Miles. I'm going to make an assumption that Rena's speaking to, when she said the city determined, she's speaking to the height study. Would you make that same assumption?
Yeah, I believe they're speaking to the zoning of the site, either to the existing zoning or the height and character study, but I think the question holds for both.
So, you know, in looking at the, I'm minimize it. So in looking at the site characteristics, of course, working with Barry, we looked at that surrounding context and in consideration of the proposed development. We did look at what those requirements are. So currently the rear yard setback is 7.5 meters under the current zoning, and that is what is proposed. And with respect to height, the height is currently proposed at 14 meters, which is approximately four stories. And in considering the context and the policy framework and the city's goals for intensification, and we felt that there was definitely increased opportunity for increased height and density on this site. And looking at that context, we know that there's very limited opportunity for intensification within the glebe, but that we definitely want to see residents, more residents in this walkable neighborhood where there's plenty of opportunities for commercial, personal service uses, amenities, access to, parks and green space. So, you know, we felt that that context was appropriate to look at greater height. And working with Barry, that design analysis, we've come to the conclusion that the proposed development is appropriate.
Okay. And did you want to touch on the height and character study? Because I think you've already alluded to it in your answer that greater intensification is desired here by city planning, and that's why they're upzoning this site already by two stories. Could you speak to why not just go with the already proposed increase?
I'll speak to it briefly. You know, we've reviewed the recommendations of the height and character study, as Carolyn mentioned, and Councillor Menard. Like, we've had conversations with everybody involved, including Peter, who's been running with this study. And we don't agree with the same conclusions that have been arrived at with respect to the height. So, you know, we've looked at it, and this is what we are proposing and feel that is appropriate.
Thanks, Kirsten. Okay, so the next most upvoted question is one near and dear to the Capital Ward office, and that is from Murray Wong. Is there an affordable housing component to this development?
I think Greg would speak to that if he's there, but certainly affordable housing is a big theme in most, almost all of our rental buildings. If we choose to pursue CMHC financing, adventitious financing is a requirement for affordable housing. So it's premature actually to figure out, but the developer's rep might have a comment about this. Certainly in terms of size and variety of units, there's a notion of trying to make these units affordable, but I'll let Greg speak to it. I do know on several other files, just the means of financing determines a fair amount about affordability, because CMHC terms right now of high ratio loans really mandate providing a certain percentage of affordable housing. And affordable is a very loose term. So you will know that we do a lot of work for the not-for-profit sector, and it's a very malleable term, whether that's 10% below market. And you know, that might mean nothing to anyone, but perhaps Greg might have a comment.
Well, Barry, I don't know that I could actually expand it much more than how you have so eloquently described it from a development perspective. We've yet to really investigate this aspect of it. Obviously, it does have an impact on the development of the pro forma and on any further advancements to this rezoning, but we haven't gone down that path at this point in time. We're looking to keep all our options open.
Okay. Thank you for that answer. Moving right along, I did have a question that went to the answered category, but I don't think got an answer. And this is from an anonymous attendee that received a couple of upvotes as well. And it says, just for my own clarity, if the study is referred to as the Bank Street study, height and character study, why is Chamberlain Avenue on it? Peter, would you like to speak to that, or Christopher Moyes?
Yeah, we included properties near Bank Street and the Glebe. Sorry, I have a cat on me here. It's partly just to include properties that are nearby, but also it's because, you know, as I think Kirsten mentioned before, there is a bit of a kind of a push-pull thing going on here between the properties at the very north end of the Glebe and on Bank Street itself. You know, for various reasons, largely related to heritage, we're really trying to keep the heights low on Bank Street in the Glebe and provide more opportunities for intensification on first on the larger properties and then the properties generally at the north end of the study area. So for that reason, really, there is really that, you know, a relationship between those properties at the north end, both on Chamberlain and Isabella, to the other properties on Bank Street proper.
I'll just add too, just briefly, Miles, the BIA boundaries as well, their representation goes to this area as well. So they've got portions that aren't directly on Bank Street in the Glebe. They also are around Isabella and Chamberlain.
Okay, thank you for that explanation. The next question is from Dan Maloney. And I believe he had a clarification message as well to this, but I'll just read the initial question out first. Regarding building mass, are you suggesting that the mass of going vertical for 13 stories, I believe he corrects that to 10, at the east side is comparable to losing possibly 3 stories on the west side? The exchange for mass seems heavily unbalanced. And just to get that clarification message below, an extra 10 stories on the east side, if we assume 6 stories, is what is appropriate.
Well, I think the easy answer to that is that you're looking at height, as one thing, but not about mass. And the fact that the footprint is so small on the west side, I don't think it's a dollars per dollars answer, but the question whether it's 6, 8, or 9 stories, basically we make the case that the deployment of mass is more elegant and a better answer using a small footprint and introducing the height. So it's not, you know, and as opposed to using all of the mass, the bulk of the full site. And there's a number of things that go into that. I think going back to the original slide I showed of the site plan, the amount that we invest at the ground plane to take away to be able to deal with the issue of visitor parking, access, garbage, pickup, turnaround, and leave, eat a lot into your square footage. So.
Okay. We're going to go right ahead here. I see the questions piling up, so I'm going to try to get through them quickly. Next one is from Mike McGuire. He says, please explain the request for a decrease in setback. Sorry, I think you meant to say how. Please explain how the request for a decrease in setback will work. Does that mean there will be less space between the building and the south fence abutting Rosebery properties than normally regulated? If yes, why is this being sought?
Hi, so as previously mentioned, so the current zoning on the site requires a 7.5 meter setback. The city did approve high-rise zoning provisions in, I believe it was 2019, which are actually under appeal. So from a technical perspective, we have to look to those as well, even though they're not in force. And so those setbacks do look at high rises and have set a minimum of 10 meters. So that is the request we're seeking, is a difference from 10 down to 7.5, which is actually, like I said, 7.5 is what's currently permitted. And in making that request, you know, we analyze the context and the proposed development and feel that's appropriate. So, you know, it's now up for the city to evaluate that request and determine if they feel the same way.
Okay. Did anybody want to add to the rationale? No? Okay. The next question is from Isabel Roy. She asks, what is the reasoning for the entrance to the garage being on the south side versus directly from Chamberlain?
So it is directly from Chamberlain. Barry and I talked about this because I asked him the same question. I wanted to understand his design. And he pointed out that, you know, when you're, because it is a one-way street and you're arriving from the west, it's easier for people arriving in cars to see that entrance at that south end of the building and to enter at that point. So it's I guess, an ease of use of the site and safety and visibility. And Barry can also add any further comments if he needs.
I think the question is why the ramp is on the south side.
Oh, sorry.
Property.
Yes.
So two things. One is surveyed the trees. Basically, this is where there's a gap in the trees. There aren't, so there's no impact on the tree cover now. That's a natural place to put it. But in addition to that, you have to be able to pull in and turn around. So having a ramp that comes directly down off the street wouldn't get us down fast enough. There's not to say that we couldn't explore some other strategy, but the combination of visitor parking and turnaround on site, just because of the character of Chamberlain, drives a lot of those responses.
Okay. Wonderful, thank you. The next question is from Angela Keller Herzog, and she says, the city is planning to be net carbon zero by 2050. Do you have any information on the carbon footprint or energy efficiency of this building?
A tad premature. I understand the question. Certainly, we are doing a number of projects right now, passive house projects for auto community housing, and most of our projects are LEED certified. It's a tad early when we get into the details of how this building is put together, but I can assure you that from a number of perspectives, this building, put this density in this location, makes a ton of sense. Number one is it's close to transit, so there's, you know, less reliance on the car. We have places to park cars down below, but I fully believe that most of the time during the week, people are going walking or basically taking a bike. So I mean, that, and then in combination with increasing density, and you know all the theory behind that, but just the building itself and the energy strategies with respect to the building envelope, and also whether we invest in ground source heat pump, which we're doing on several high-rise projects, including the redevelopment of Blair Street at the Blair Avenue transit station. So those are premature. but they're not, you know, we haven't taken a position yet.
And Barry, you referenced other buildings that are LEED certified. Can you speak to what level of LEED certification they tend to be?
Well, because Southminster is going, I'm just looking at the website today, Southminster United Church is going for LEED Platinum. That's with Windmill.
Yep.
Most of them are LEED Gold. And there's several of them obviously fit within a larger context. So for instance, we know that Greystone, for instance, is a LEED certified, one of the first neighborhoods certified in North America. So we're not there yet.
Okay, well, we're definitely supportive of a LEED Platinum standard. I'm gonna move on to the next question here. And it's from Tyler. He asks, what is the plan for separation along the properties on Rosebery? Will a fence be erected to separate the units on the ground floor? While the height of the podium is equal to the buildings on Rosebery, homes around the tower have substantially more exposure to the tower. Was this considered in the proposal, and why was the tower chosen for that side? So a couple questions there. I believe you all can see the question written out. So I'll throw to you on the development team first. Kirsten?
Sure, I'll speak. So the separation is along the properties on Rosebery. So the proposed setback, so that's the rear yard setback, would be 7.5 meters. Will a fence be erected to separate the units on the ground floor? I'd pass that to Barry, but it might be a little bit premature for you know, detailed unit layout or, you know, those kinds of details for actual individual units. So the height of the podium the height of the podium, as Barry mentioned, was considered. I'll let Barry speak to it a little bit more briefly, but from a planning perspective, you know, that residential neighborhood to the south was evaluated and considered, as well as the floor plate of the tower. And in looking at the context and the design elements, we felt that that was appropriate. And I'll let Barry speak more about to why the tower was chosen for that side from a design perspective.
Difficult questions. Let me deal with, there was a number of them. I thought the question really about the separation really had to do with the detailed landscape plan and site plan about the backyards, because we heard in our consultation with the residents of Noseberry, there's a fair amount of disgruntlement around the existing condition along that that north property line. So clearly what happens at the backyards will be fully fenced and privacy separated for a number of reasons. Visual separation, but in addition to that, cars entering, leaving, you don't want your lights to be shining in their backyards. But the other notion, I don't understand the second part of the question. All I can say is that we basically shaped the building to have the smallest exposure to the south and to the units on Rosebery. And that's why the angle basically reduces that area. But as best I understand the question.
Okay, Tyler, if you wanna clarify things, feel free to add on now. Barry, there was the piece about why the east side of the tower being on the east side of the podium rather than the west. I missed that while I was sorting questions, but did you get to that?
That's a good question. It's probably a tad more subjective. You could say, could the tower go anywhere along the podium? And I think it's possible. I think it was shaped by my knowledge of Chamberlain and wanting to have as much of the lower part of the building exposed first as you're coming from the west to east, so that you could clearly see how you could enter. It's not to say that the building couldn't be, the tower couldn't be put in a different location on that podium, but that was the rationale where we got to at this point in time.
Okay. Okay, thank you for that question, Tyler, and that answer, folks. I'll get to the next one here. We're going just by upvotes here, and I'm also trying to prioritize first-time questioners. So I have one from Andrea Redway, She asks, a 16-story versus 6 or 4-story building will clearly have a much more significant negative impact on the privacy of the residents on Rosebery, Powell, and other surrounding streets. Has this been addressed in any way? As a nearby resident, I have no doubt that my use and enjoyment of my property will be impacted by the shadow and the decrease in privacy.
So,
let me deal with that.
Okay, sure.
I think we cover this in our presentation, but I'm going to make this simple notion. You take a mid-rise building that really wants to optimize density, whether it's 4, 6, or 9 stories high, and half the units basically are low down. Their predominant view is down. I think you're going to be looking into people's backyards. It's my position. I understand this is a personal position, that when you actually have a small footprint, yes, you will have overlook from those lower floors of the tower, but the upper parts of the tower are not going to be looking down. They're going to be looking out. So that would be that's my case. And I believe that strongly. So when you talk about impacts, that's why it comes into the notion of privacy, 2, skyplane. Because the skyplane, basically, when you have a 6-story continuous building, for those people that are on Rosebery, they're looking into a continuous wall of a building. And so that's a rather substantial piece. And the last one, in terms of sun shadowing, I'd be happy, as part of our zoning application, we submitted all the sun shadows. And I can tell you that the impact from sun shadowing is absolutely minimal. Absolutely minimal from 2 perspectives, both the way we shaped the building and the fact that the retention of all those substantial trees on that side actually has more impact on the backyard sun shadowing in the summer when it counts than actually anything else.
Okay. Are you suggesting trees couldn't be retained if it was a 6-story building?
No, I'm just saying that the trees have an impact in terms of sun shadowing.
Okay, just wanted to clarify, thank you. I have a question next from June Creelman. She'd like to direct her question to Peter Giles. Can you remind us of the rationale in the Bank Street height and character study for 6 stories here, whereas higher heights would be permitted for Isabella? What were the specific factors that led to the 6-story recommendation here?
Yeah, it's a good question, June, and nice to see June's name there. I know she's been involved in the study since the very beginning. Okay, so for this one, we didn't have a whole lot of time to, or at least I didn't take a lot of time to talk about this at the last open house. You know, I was trying to explain the rationale for the entire study area, so I kind of glossed over it. Not glossed over it. I should have spent more time on it. So I can tell you a bit more about it now, and I'm glad it was asked in the context of Isabella, because that's where there's some confusion sometimes. Because when you're going eastbound on Chamberlain, and as it turns into Isabella, I've had people ask me, well, you know, isn't it the same context, right? You've got you know, one way, fast moving street, as Barry was saying, you know, arterials, transit priority, and then the properties on the north side there on Chamberlain, on Isabella, are similar depths. They're both edge conditions, similar situation, you know, facing the highway. But what's different here? What's different is what's to the south. Okay, and that's what makes all the difference. On the other side of Bank, where Isabella backs onto Pretoria, what we have is R4 zoning. Okay, so that already allows for maximum 14.5-meter buildings, so essentially a low-rise 4-story apartment buildings. On the east side on Rosebery, we're looking at R3 with maximum 11-meter buildings. What that really means is that the buildings on Rosebery are not anticipated to change, whereas the ones in Pretoria are already anticipated to change to eventually, you know, become more urban to low-rise apartment buildings. The other factors, Rosebery is a very short dead-end street that ends at Central Park. It's only about 165 meters. The buildings are, okay, well, and on the other side, Pretoria is 600 and something meters connecting Bank to Queen Elizabeth Drive. So it's a much busier street already. And we're only, there's only properties on the north side of Pretoria on, you know, a bit more than half the block, you know, because of 460 O'Connor at the east end of the block, that's a large through block property. The other factors we've got, the building stock is a bit different, right? We've got generally two and a half story buildings on Pretoria, the mixed condition, and some of them have been converted to commercial, whereas on Rosebery, we get classically two and a half story homes, brick, good condition, as far as I know, entirely residential. So those are the main reasons that we decided that Rosebery was a much more sensitive condition that then needed to be protected compared to Isabella. So what we did is that we looked at the urban design guidelines for high-rise buildings and the application of the 45 degree angular plane and where that falls and most importantly where it should start. On Pretoria, because we're already anticipating a changeover on the north side of Pretoria, we're able to start that 45 degree angular plane at that south property line on the north side of Pretoria, and you go up to maximum height and zoning, 14 and a half meters, and then you set that 45 degree angular plane going north, right? And you go all the way across the block that way. And that's what gives you the maximum 16 on Isabella. On the other side of Bank, when looking at this more sensitive condition, we had to really decide where that 45 degree angular plane would apply. And, you know, if we want to protect those homes on Rosebery, it means you have to set it not at the front property line, but you have to set it somewhere behind those homes. And once you do that, then you're not looking at a high-rise building anymore. It's a mid-rise building. And then as far as the recommendations in the study, you know, we modeled nine stories. And here's where there's a distinction that I need to make here with a secondary plan compared to an individual application, is that in a secondary plan, we're not considering detailed massing, right? This is, so we kind of have to assume a worst case scenario, which means, you know, a nine story building would have considerable impacts on Rosebery in terms of, you know, as mentioned before, in terms of shadowing, late day shadowing and privacy. Six stories is different. Once you model it out, you see that six stories, especially with, you know, that steps down at the back, hardly has any impact in terms of those late day shadow impacts in the summer. So it's really a different condition, and that's where we can really start to see some real kind of protection of those properties in terms of shadow impacts, and to some extent still the privacy impacts, especially with that the stepping back above the fourth story at the rear. So that's really the rationale, and you know, and it does still address the part in the OP that Kirsten raised, that where, you know, if you have an arterial road and you have a transit priority street, that we can see additional building height, and you know, we have done that in this case, although it is quite limited, you know, from 4 to 6 stories.
Right on. Thank you so much for that really comprehensive response, Peter. I know obviously it just demonstrates how much thought was put into this, and I know it was a long public-driven deliberative process with you and members of the community that led to the outcome of the heightened character study. So just want to again appreciate that. Okay, thanks June for the question. The next question is from Rena again. She's quoting something that was referenced earlier, lighting concerns will be addressed. Can you please elaborate? Does the applicant plan on addressing this with a landscaping plan, which was not submitted with the application? Question mark.
Hi, Miles, I can speak to that. So yes, at site plan, the site plan control application will require a very detailed level of submission for the proposed development. So once again, you'll see the site plan submitted, but you'll see lighting, you'll see a very detailed landscape plan, you know, which will have aspects such as the fencing detail, the height, the material, et cetera. And the reason that's not submitted at zoning bylaw amendment process is that the city recognizes that a great level of detail is required, and that the zoning is looking at a higher level policy framework, and the city is evaluating it from that perspective and providing a recommendation on if they feel that that, you know, proposed development is appropriate from that policy framework. Whereas the site plan control moves into, okay, there's zoning on the site that permits the proposed development, and now we're going to look very detailed at that. It is a very significant cost to developers, so they recognize that separation in the application processes. So,
okay. I mean, some applicants do come forward with amendments, zoning amendments, and site plan at the same time. Is there
That's right. A
particular reason you folks didn't want to do that here? I mean, it does, the benefit obviously being that folks can look at this in totality and evaluate better if the zoning amendment makes sense, if they, when they've seen the other aspects of this, including the mitigation that Rena has raised here.
So it's just it's personal choice that the property owner's chosen to submit just a zoning bylaw amendment. Sorry, there's conceptual landscaping shown on it. There's a, you know, still a high level of detail that's gone into it with floor plans, amassing, elevations, et cetera, you know, servicing analysis. So, you know, at this time, it's a sufficient amount of information for the city to evaluate for a zoning bylaw amendment.
Okay, thank you for that answer. Okay, we'll move right along here. We have another anonymous attendee who's put a mysterious question forward. Just kidding, it's not actually mysterious, but they're asking, can you speak to whether or not this development complies with the high-rise guidelines? Perhaps Steve, you might wanna address this question first and open the floor from after that.
Okay, so as part of the circulation, staff has had to, development review staff has had to do their own analysis. We've of course considered the study that is being conducted by policy. So in terms of the meeting the guidelines, the we do have concern about the lack of transition. We do have concern about the encroachment upon the 45 degree angle. We do have concern about the separation distances. Okay, so those are elements. Like if you want to know about specifically which guidelines, one that I could point out is the lot conditions that should normally be met for such height, such density. Anyway, there can be a lot we can look at it like so with the proper lot size, you get to meet the proper distance. You also have better chances to fit within the 45 degree angle. So essentially that's in a nutshell where we have concern.
Okay. Yeah.
And I should point out that they are guidelines, but then again, the official plan clearly says that where you don't have a secondary plan, you apply the appropriate guidelines. You refer to the urban design guidelines. And in addition to that, there's an ongoing study. It's not yet approved, but it only makes sense to look at the, the analysis, compare the analysis for consistency. I hope that answers the question.
Thanks, Steve. Yeah, it sounds like there's some departures there given the current proposal and the lot size it's on. So appreciate the clarity there. Did anybody else want to speak to that question before I move on?
Yeah, I'll speak to that.
Okay, Barry.
You know, there's a lot of guidelines that come under the high-rise guidelines, specifically about the shape of the building, the base, the middle, the top, basically the way you handle parking, the way you handle discrete entrances to parking garages. There are so many things that Steve has nicely glossed over. And I find the comment about the shape of the building and stepping back absolutely hilarious, when you're considering the Minto proposal on Isabella. You set up an artificial angular plane and then you accept a building whose footprint is 12,000 square feet, 11,000 meters, 1,100 meters. And the high-rise guidelines speak to a footprint of being 750, and ours is 655. So there's a lot of dimensions to high-rise stuff. I think you're being rather selective in those high-rise guidelines that you're speaking to. And if you want to look at basically buildings which respond in a high profile, what you're actually speaking to is a larger context and the context of impact. But in terms of high-rise guidelines themselves, I think this building would stand up remarkably well.
Okay.
The approval process is not completed. So this is a first analysis that was completed by staff. We're hearing tonight comments from the development team, from the community, et cetera. So there's gonna be further discussions, but I do maintain that yes, there's a lot of guidelines to be looked at, but there's, I guess the lot size is one of the thing that needs to be looked at as first, and then you focus into more of the detailed massaging of the development. So anyway, but as I said, we're in the middle of the approval process. So I'm hearing all arguments here, and staff is not yet at a definite position on the application. So that's where we stand right now.
Steve. And just because Barry referenced the Minto development at Isabella, is that hasn't been approved yet either, has it?
Steve, no, the one on Isabella, no.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, it's not a good compare. It's not analogous in the sense that we don't actually know what the outcome of that development would be.
Well, what I meant is when you get to the argument about the 750 square meters, I think you should first look at the lot size, if the tower is appropriate to start with, and then if it's determined that it's appropriate, well, then that's where you go into more of the massaging about the floor plate of the tower, et cetera. So there's an order to look at these guidelines. So it's not necessarily focused on one. As I said, it should not be, a pick and choose. You should start with the funded ones and then go into the details one.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay, so I have our next question here. I'm going to go to Todd Saunders first, because I don't believe we've heard from Todd. He asks, what measures would be put in place to mitigate construction impacts on the surrounding residences during construction, especially around the two-level underground structure?
I think there's enough examples of buildings that around the city where there's a whole process in place in terms of how you protect the site, shoring that's required, engineered shoring to protect buildings, and there's a fair amount already in place. I don't, you know, rest assured you're not going to get a building permit unless you've got a specific plan for how this is done from a constructability perspective.
Okay, thank you for that, Barry. Move on to the next question here, and it's from Christy Ross. How can this development be reconciled with the Bank Street height and character study? And the questions for the proponent team, and what are the thoughts of the city as well?
Miles, I think I'd answered it previously, but just to reiterate, you know, we've been in contact with everybody involved in the height study, the GCA, Peter Giles, we've met with Councillor Menard. And we don't share the same opinion and conclusions that the city has come to. So we're moving forward and going through the appropriate processes with regard to seeking additional height on our site.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Fair enough. I know you've already said that. I got the sense from Christy's question that this might be asking about a potential compromise, even a reconciliation between what's being proposed here and what the height and character study is putting forward, but it sounds like there's not movement on that. So we'll move on. The next question is June Creelman again. To the proponents, can you please go back to the traffic plan and show the relationship of the entrance slash exit to the crosswalk? Children use that crosswalk to get to Glashan, and I'd like to understand if there are any safety risks. And that might be an invitation as well to share your screen again if you'd like, Kirsten. Or
yes, so I'll just do that, and then we'll see if this is the best one to look at here. One second, okay?
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so I think this is the best one to visually show just in comparison to the surrounding street network. The site plan just focuses in on the street, on the site itself. So, I mean, Steve can speak to the city's review process, but through the zoning bylaw amendment application, a transportation impact assessment was submitted. So it does look at the surrounding street network, the context, the traffic levels anticipated for the site, as well as existing traffic levels. And so the transportation staff at the city will review that and share any comments or questions to clarify anything, you know, such as this question. And unfortunately, we don't have a transportation consultant on the call today, but I think we can certainly get more information and relay that through Steve if there's further questions after looking at this this plan.
Okay, and anything specific to the crosswalk that you wanted to add there, or we'll get to those details later?
We'll get to those details later. I know that, I'm not a transportation consultant, so I won't speak for them, but I know that I believe that the GCA and the conversations we've had with Carolyn and Peter and the planning committee before, it's a question that's come up. So we'll definitely continue to look at that and make sure that safety is maintained at the crosswalk.
Okay, thank you for that answer, Kirsten. Our next question here is from Kay Roy. They're basically saying the permitted maximum building height has been set to 14 meters, the current height cap, presumably for a reason. So how would increasing the height fourfold compromise this reason? And I think that's maybe a question directed towards city staff, given its planning department that came up with that zoning envelope. So I don't know if you want to answer Steve or someone else from the city, or we can also go to the applicant for comment.
Well, I was actually looking at the transportation comments here. So the question you've just read is the one from Christy from K. Roy.
Yeah. And I think they're trying to highlight what there must be a reason for pre-existing height caps, and how is that reason essentially compromised by going ahead with a fourfold increase?
Well, I guess the first answer is that the reason for that height is it first allows more height along Chamberlain, then it allows for Rosebery, but it's a very sensitive increase. So there was a reasoning at the time. So the zoning that was put in place there was put in place several years ago, as you can see in the ongoing study, the Bank Street study. This height is being increased of two floors. Not sure if I'm answering the question, but that's what comes to my mind.
Yeah, no, I think that, and I think a lot of what has been said probably since that that question was posed is basically spoken to that piece. Seeing no one chomping at the bit here, I'm going to move on to our next question. And my questions are moving around on me. Here we go. Okay, so we have another anonymous attendee. Years ago, there was an uproar at Bank and Homewood about the noise from a large HVAC system on the roof of a tall building. People were concerned about the noise pollution. What is your plan?
So as part of the submission for site plan, moving to site plan, as the design continues to evolve, a noise study will be required to understand stationary noise sources from the development and how those noises, what level those noises are and what mitigation requirements are required. I can't speak to where the mechanical will be or the HVAC will be in the building itself, but Barry might be able to, or it might be too preliminary, you know, as we're still moving through design.
Okay, Barry, did you want to add? You're on mute.
Well, I think if they're referring to, it's the, they're referring to the Glebe Center, if I'm not mistaken, which is a six-story building. And in fact, we're talking about a building that's substantially higher. I would venture to say that the noise pollution from the Queensway would exceed any mechanical noise that you would have from the top. But certainly, we certainly haven't had any feedback from mechanical noise for any of the buildings that are in the higher profile. So I can't really comment specifically, but you know, I haven't had a question like that in a long, long time.
Okay. The next question we'll go to is from Mary Walsh. She says, as a resident across the park, I'm concerned with the height and its impact beyond the immediate Roseberry neighborhood. The look across rather than down is significant. Also, the increase of traffic along this very busy corridor is a cause of great concern. Mail delivery vehicles can park on the road and do block a lane along Chamberlain now. This will increase. So it's more of a comment, but if you'd like to address that comment to any panelists, please do so now.
I think, you know, Barry spoke previously to the skyplane and views and projecting. I don't know exactly where Mary's house is, but views are not protected in the city of Ottawa, but certainly we appreciate residents do have that concerns. And so Barry's team did look at that and we saw that analysis being undertaken, that the impact and the views will be minimal. We are fairly close to the Queensway and Centretown. So I imagine too, without having seen an analysis, you see those background buildings from Centretown as well, just due to the proximity. But from an increase in traffic, as I said, a transportation impact assessment has been submitted. So city staff will review that report and understand any traffic impacts from the proposed development on the existing road network. With respect to mail delivery and vehicles, as Barry mentioned, the design of the ground floor has been carefully thought out to bring those vehicles off of Chamberlain, in acknowledgement of that street being a very fast paced, vehicular movement. So those vehicles will be coming in and there will be opportunity for drop off internally so that they can pull off the street, park for 5-10 minutes as they drop off and pull back out again.
Thank you. I think just to expand on Mary's question a bit, there's, the concern of increased traffic, I think, is also probably related to the parking on site, right? If you build parking, tenants with cars will come, as we know. And did you want to speak, and I don't know if it was covered in the initial presentation, but how much parking is proposed for the site and is it above or below zoning requirements?
So there's 10 at-grade parking spaces proposed. Those are a combination of visitor and for the small, personal service, commercial service uses that, anybody can access very easily. And there's 100 underground parking spaces. And there's 112 bicycle parking spaces proposed as well. I think that, as we all know, there's a fine balance. We hear both sides of the story from residents, concern about not providing enough parking, concern about providing too much parking. We're meeting the zoning bylaw requirement. And, I think there's a difference between parking and traffic, right? We need to remember that people have cars, but it doesn't necessarily mean they're driving them all the time, especially in a neighborhood as this site, where there's easy access to transit, easy access for pedestrian connections and cycling. So, I can't pull numbers out of the TIA right now, but looking holistically at it, I envision that we'll see people reserving their car use to the weekends to get out of the neighborhood versus coming into the neighborhood, you know, for back and forth daily uses, because they'll be taking advantage of that existing alternative transportation modes that are present in the neighborhood.
Thanks, Kirsten. Okay, so we're gonna move on to the next question here. It's from Kay Roy again. They're asking for you to please explain the impact of the wind or of wind on houses on Rosebery.
So as part of the zoning bylaw amendment application, a wind analysis is required. So the terms of reference though from the city do require an analysis on the subject site. So that analysis has shown that there's no negative impacts on the pedestrian environment in front of the site or around the immediate frontage of Chamberlain or on the proposed amenity spaces. But it doesn't look to the houses on Rosebery. So, that's something we would have to take back and look at further.
Okay. Carolyn, I saw your hand was up there.
Sorry, if I may, just very, very briefly. Kirsten, can you just, I don't have that study in front of me, but it's been a while since I had a look at it. But my recollection offhand is that it suggested that the sort of microclimate of the third story amenity space, given wind impacts. I don't even want to try and paraphrase really, but it was, I'll say, mediocre at best. Can you confirm, deny, revise my understanding? Because I remember my takeaway was that was not necessarily going to be great space to be using as an outdoor space if the best that it was going to provide, given what I assume to be wind impacts coming down the side of the tower, they were going to be significant enough to reduce the quality of the microclimate to, I'll say mediocre, but I'm sure that's not quite correct. Anyway, if you can confirm or update that, that would be terrific.
And Carolyn, I am also not a wind expert, so we might have to get this translated into more plain language all of us. But yes, so actually I have it here. So it says conditions at the level 4 amenity terrace. So that's that amenity terrace you see on the 3-story podium.
Correct.
Are predicted to be mostly suitable for sitting. So for sitting during the typical use period of late spring through early autumn. So, that typical time would be outside because Ottawa has a lot of cold weather. With regions that are suitable for sitting at least 75% of the time during the typical use period. So recommended these conditions be considered acceptable. So they do look at those different time periods throughout the year based on weather conditions and wind patterns, and then when people would be using it based on typical usage. Yeah.
Okay, perhaps a bit of interpretation there. Maybe it was the mostly acceptable, mostly suitable and acceptable, not exactly a glowing recommendation for that space. Anyway, I'll leave it there. I don't want to belabor that, but it would be useful to understand that better.
Okay. Sounds like the wind experts were not blown away with the proposal. Sorry about the pun, folks. I know it's getting late. Okay, so we have our next question. It's from an anonymous attendee once again. What is the anticipated time required to complete the project from demolition to occupancy? What is the projected impact to local vehicle traffic with concurrent construction projects at Chamberlain and Isabella? What will be the ultimate impact to local vehicle traffic once both buildings are populated? So we're getting into TIA territory again here, and understandably, we, just like our wind experts, we don't have our traffic experts at the ready, but there's the first part of that question as well, which I think we haven't touched on at all. So Kirsten?
I may pass this to Greg from a construction perspective, but I think Steve can chime in too if he wants, but the process for this, the city's processes for viewing zoning bylaw amendments and subsequent site plan control applications is quite lengthy. So construction would definitely not begin in 2021 based on where we are in the process. But Greg, if you could chime in just more about, or Barry perhaps as well, the time it would take to construct the proposed development.
I think you're looking at 24 months. By the time you put a shovel in the ground, 24 months to basically complete the project.
Okay.
And that was exactly what I was going to say, Barry. And it may be some move-in, some deficiencies, but that's what you're looking at typically.
Okay. And then with respect to, you know, traffic impacts for construction, as Barry mentioned earlier, all construction projects require a traffic management plan as part of that building permit process that's reviewed in detail by the city to understand what those impacts will be. And Miles, as you mentioned, I think like we'd have to come back with just further details about the ultimate impact with respect to traffic. We'd have to look at both TIAs and get some numbers from both of those TIAs to understand that.
And that makes sense. Okay, thank you for that answer. I think the one thing I'll just emphasize in that question from our anonymous friend is that this probably should be considered in concert with the Isabella project also being proposed, of course. And so hopefully that's part of the TIA scope. So I'll put that one in the done pile. We're actually getting through the questions, folks. We're getting close to the end. So thanks to our panelists for going through this. And thanks especially to the folks in the audience giving us these questions. Murray Wong has another question for us. He says, for those of us that weren't privy to the direct consultations with the residents of Rosebery, what is their preference, if any, for the current proposal versus a six-story massing? And I think multiple folks could probably speak to that. Sean, you might want to weigh in on that as, you know, obviously the counselor who's been hearing from residents. But I know, Steve, you as well have been receiving comments from residents of Rosebery, and frankly, the applicant is aware of that now too. So feel free to jump in to any of you. Sean, do you want to go first?
I don't think there's much to say. A lot of Rosebery residents have written to us. They have concerns about the project, and they've been outlining their concerns very clearly around how this is going to affect their own livelihoods there. And I think that one of the points that a lot of them are making is we welcome development in the area. We welcome new development here. But that there needs to be some parameters around it. So that's the gist of what I'm hearing from Rosebery residents, but I don't think we need to go into detail, too much detail on that question.
Miles, I think just like Councillor Menard said, those are the comments we received. We did hold two meetings. So one set of meetings with a group of residents that, share those comments as Councillor Menard shared, but then two other residents who are supportive of the proposed development. So we have received positive comments as well.
Okay, great. That's good to hear. Okay, we can move on to our next question. And it's from Jane Bauer. Would not this project with its height set a precedent which could be followed in many other places on the perimeter of the neighborhood? However, they might not be done with the special considerations that this project is trying to take and just have massing and height. So I think that's, Kirsten, if you want to speak to that, but also Steve, you might want to speak to the issue of precedent. That's certainly something we hear a lot when we have consultations with proposals that are looking to go beyond the existing zoning envelope.
Yeah, so when it gets to precedent, there was a lot of arguments presented about the immediate impact. So you always have to look at a general context, a closer context, and then an immediate context. And by looking at the general context, the replicability is something that also needs to be considered. So yes, this could set a precedent. Again, having said that, each site have their own characteristics, so it's kind of a difficult question to answer.
Yeah, I
think it's a really interesting question. I think this is something that's often said to on projects that we work with, and just anecdotally, not everyone is sensitive to what happens. So you do the classic example that I can give you is the Lansdowne Review Panel determined they wanted two towers at Lansdowne. They wanted them to have height. They mandated that in the design thing. And then I get paraphrases, Jughead developers coming to me and saying, you know, they got this over here, so obviously we can do this over here. And the context, just to speak to Steve's concept, every you would hope that every site had a different context, and you weren't simply subject to that simplistic notion that that's 22 stories, I get 30 over here. But you know, the reality is that that mentality exists. And Carolyn would know that, Sean, everybody on this panel would know, including Chris down there with the great beard, he would know that, Christopher, that this happens. And I don't know what you can do about it. Hopefully people respond to project based upon their merits, their strong merits, as opposed to a sense of entitlement.
Yeah, I think
Miles.
Sorry, Brian.
I just wanted to add something to that. Sorry, I've been, you know, silently listening as Kirsten's been doing such a good job. But I one thing to add is that, as everybody recognizes, I mean, the GLEEB is advancing the height and character study at this point. And I think there's a reason for that, right? The reason for that is because they want to try and create a policy framework, a new policy framework that development will have to operate within. And so this development and the applications are coming or submitted ahead of that approved study. So the most relevant policy considerations, in fact, you know, from a legal perspective, the only relevant policy considerations are the existing official plan policies. But once that height study gets approved, and of course it, you know, just as it's constructed right now, it could change by way of council. They may decide to do something different. It's subject to appeal and it could be changed through that. But at the end of the day, once it's set in place, although there's an opportunity under the Planning Act to always change those studies, it's much harder for us as planners to, we don't take that very lightly, let's put it this way. So we have to, you know, really find a very unique circumstance where a property exhibits characteristics that we think maybe the study was still not fine-grained enough, right? And so that would be a circumstance where we might look at it and go, well, even though the study says for this, in this case, it might be six, you know, for some reason, we think something greater could be contemplated. So the short answer to what I'm saying is that study will give more certainty to the planning realities, but planning by its nature has a certain fluidity just established under the Planning Act. Anybody can and try to amend things from time to time. But as planners, we put a higher degree of respect, if you will, once those secondary plans are done.
Right on, thanks. Yeah, yeah. The whole precedent thing's a tricky question, so I appreciate the answers there. I mean, it's like Steve said, site-specific context, except the context is kind of impacted by how many tall buildings are around it, so there's an indirect impact. And as Barry said, I mean, we can certainly confirm that developers will use precedent as an argument for their buildings to be approved. So. It's a complicated question, and the answers were great. So thank you for that.
Carolyn's got her hand up there, Miles.
Oh, I'm sorry, Carolyn. Just feel free to jump in and cut me off in future.
Okay, sorry. I know I think we're getting into overtime here, but just context is clearly important, but correct me if I'm wrong. I don't have the official or current official plan in front of me, but I do believe that there are instances in the official plan that specifically allow for greater height to be considered when there is existing greater height in the surrounding area. And I don't have the language right in front of me to be able to quote it, but so it's not just a matter of precedent, it's actually baked into the official plan itself. So I would just add that to the conversation.
Okay, thanks for that. And you raise a good point. I actually was having such a good time with everyone that I hadn't kept my eye on the clock, and it is indeed already later than we anticipated. And the fact that that hasn't been flagged already is a testament to everyone on the call. Thank you for carrying on with this. What I'll say is, look, we're almost at 8:20. I think a hard stop at 8:30 makes sense. I suspect we can get through the questions that remain in that time, and if not, just want everyone to know, if you have questions, if you have comments, you can email them to our office, capitalward@ottawa.ca. You all should have that email address as you've received email communications about this event, if you've RSVP'd. And you should email comments to Steve Goche, the planner on the file, who's speaking to us tonight. His email is on our website on the page for this event, so you can check it out there. It's simply his name at ottawa.ca. Okay, so thanks for that. I'm going to try to get through, assuming that's okay, what I just said for the 8:30 hard stop. We're already past eight, so here we are. Okay, so simple question on mechanics. Oh, this is a good question. Good. Steve Goche let us know the specific methods for how to get our comments into the city. So I think I just answered that question, Steve, but is there anything you'd like to add to it?
I guess the best way to provide comments is to write directly to me. So it's steve.gauthier@ottawa.ca.
Thanks, Steve. Okay. And I think we've actually answered this question as well about the difference between Chamberlain and the Minto proposal. So I'm going to overlook that. We're actually really very close to the end, my folks. I have another one from an anonymous attendee here. It's got to be pretty clear to everyone that the height increase is tied to increased revenue for the developer and not building a better community. I think that's an invitation to speak to that balance you were talking about before, Barry, because you've been saying these are not mutually exclusive ends. But we have somebody in the community suggesting that maybe they are. So did you want to speak further to height being profitable versus best interests of the community?
You know, I think I'm repeating myself a little bit. I just think that the deployment of mass on site is the most important part as opposed to absolute notion about height. So I'll just leave it there. I in terms of community interest, I look at the big things. I look at the first three floors that being strongly articulated towards the street, trying to make Chamberlain into something more humane by way of a walking environment, introduction of street trees. So it's got scale, it's got detail, etc. And then height being very small and slender. And I fully understand that not everyone agrees with me on that. And just while I'm speaking, in my exchange with Steve about the high-rise guidelines, that theme came up. Someone chirped me a note, and I just want to check myself. I may have been abrupt, and my tone may have been totally aligned, so I would apologize for that. I think it's important in terms of fiercely debating things that you understand that I'm debating those things because I actually believe these things. So. But if my tone was out of line, I want to fully apologize to the people that are in the room.
Should check in on more city council meetings, Bear. I'm sure you see your fair amount, but game compared to that. But anyway.
Oh no, I just you know, like honestly, my wife says you got, every once in a while you express that incorrectly.
Yeah, no, thank you for speaking.
And she's probably that. Right.
Thank you for flagging that, Barry. Actually, I realize now that when you are commenting on people's questions, it actually dismisses it from my queue. And I have a hell of a time trying to fish those out from the answered section. So if you don't mind, just please refrain from typing any comment because it effectively answers the question and then dismisses it from the queue. And, I see here, just for example, a question from April where you said you're happy to discuss. I actually missed that entirely, and maybe you want to speak to it a bit now. It says, Barry, I thank you for your response, but perhaps you unintentionally didn't answer my question referring to your other work. We wanted to know, A, what historical research did you do to design a building for the local context? B, the key context that is that this is a historical and rare part of the city. How did you choose your design, aside from the developer's preference? I would prefer a verbal answer, thank you. And I believe their question they're referencing before that was also put into the answered queue unwittingly.
It's a question about style.
Yeah, and they specifically raised the possibility of 1900s style high rises. So could you speak to that?
Well, I think we all know that this was once a rail corridor. So the historical reference point is in terms of historical urban form, just isn't there in the same way. So in fact, we're reinventing form, first of all, for this street in a way that we're looking to the future, right? We're looking to how do we introduce along this street some residential character that edges the glebe in a way that has never been edged before. Because if you look down the street, by the way, the site is quite large, 24,000 square feet. And as Kirsten said in an introduction, it's basically open parking lots. It's land that bordered a rail line. And the introduction of the Queensway changed all of that. And so I don't think there's a huge historical reference point in the past. It's how do we make this a more humane thing in the future? And I think there is, in fact, a work program to do trying to change the character of Chamberlain. I believe the councillor might know something about that. But it's what edge condition can we put along there that says, hey, people live here. You're going from between Bronson and Bank or Bronson to go uptown. Basically, just tone it down because there are people living along this edge. So it's really not so much about the history looking backwards. It's how do we actually turn that into a humane street looking forward?
Thank you for that answer. Okay, we're on the last two. And I'm just going to say to anybody in the audience, let's cap it here. Please don't ask any other questions. As I said earlier, please do ask questions. But in the interest of time tonight, just send those to our office and we can and to Steve and we can and get answers for you. Dan Maloney with us again here. He's asking, will garbage recycling be kept within the building under grade? Will it be removed via the ramp at the back? How will noise on removal or trucking be attenuated in that case?
Is correct. Everything's below ground and the typical methodology is simply used a winch to pull. This is done in most of the high rise. Basically, the bins are rolled out and it's on a prescribed time frame that they do that. It's professionally done. I don't believe in the situation we're going to be relying on city garbage pickup.
Okay, and is there anything planned for mitigatory landscaping or sound barrier for
that whole
air brakes on the truck, that sort of thing?
We're early days on in terms of formal site plan, but clearly that whole south property line will have a sound fence and a separate privacy screen associated with it.
Right. Okay. Thank you for that. And finally, our friend Angela Keller Herzog here. She says, given that there is a middle school directly across the Queensway and elementary schools nearby, did you consider larger units suitable for families? Also, given more work-at-home lifestyles, do you think that the apartment market may be leaning towards additional space for working at home? So it's a great question, I think. Kirsten, Barry, did you want to speak to it?
I can't speak to market, but I can give you the statistics. So of the 150 units, 43, so that's 28%, are two bedrooms, and 14 of them are two plus dens. So there is a range of larger sizes. Of course, there's also one bedroom bachelors and one plus dens. So it does provide for a variety of family sizes and family compositions to take advantage of that opportunity. But I would invite either Barry or Greg to speak from more of a marketing perspective on unit size, because I don't have experience on that.
And then I think the other part is that at grade at the rear, it's a natural place if you want to encourage families in that situation. But the final unit mix is not actually in place. But those are the two themes that come up. The two themes that I mentioned about housing tonight are recurring themes. One is housing for families to be living in a higher density, and the second is affordability.
Mm. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that. Yeah, I'll just say, there's a clear need for three bedrooms and in the core of the city. We have a lot of families that have trouble finding and accessing for affordable housing in the core. So just flag that. It sounds like decisions are still being made regarding the final makeup of the building. So thank you so much, everyone. That concludes the public consultation on 30 to 48 Chamberlain. Panelists, thank you so much. Residents, constituents, thank you as well for sitting through this and engaging with us and raising some really great questions, frankly, and touching on some really great points. There's a lot to unpack here, especially with the heightened character study. And so I think this has been a super valuable discussion. I'll just say one more time, capitalward@ottawa.ca is how you can send our office your comments or questions, but also please be sure to reach out to Steve Gauthier directly or to CC him as he is the planner on this file and will be incorporating those comments into his actual final report to the planning committee. So there you have it.
Let me just jump in on that one, Miles, just to say thank you to you for running the session today, but also on the planning piece, that is important, the planning committee date. So it looks like Steve was mentioning this could be in, I think you said April or May, Steve, that it may come to planning committee.
Could be April 18. Okay. I'll be receiving comments following this this session, and we'll discuss with the applicant, and depending on the changes, if we agree on the changes made to the development, it could proceed to April 18. Or if there's a disagreement, it could also proceed to April 18.
Okay. Yeah, so that's important. So if you're interested in commenting, you can also attend the actual planning committee meeting and comment at that meeting. So just be aware of some of those timelines. But I wanted to thank everyone as well for being here and for going through this session. Obviously, one we got to work on together collaboratively to hopefully get a better result than what we're overall seeing right now. We're seeing a lot of divergence on this one. So let's try to come together and get a better result. All together would be ideal. All right. Thank you very much. And Miles, I'll let you just lead us out here.
Yeah, no, I think you said it. Thank you for chiming in. I should have invited you to do so. So I appreciate that. Nothing left to say other than good night, everyone.
Good night. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Okay.